Hello, everybody. We'll let people come into the webinar, and we're excited to have Jason Pohl as our presenter today, and we'll just let everybody filter in. We'll wait a few more minutes as people come into the webinar, and we'll get started in about a minute. Okay, it looks like everybody is pretty much filtered in. Well, we're still getting a few more people, but I'll start. Welcome everybody to our webinar. Today we have an exciting guest, Jason Pohl, who's an industrial designer. He's been working for quite a few years with Orange County Choppers, and you're probably familiar with the hit show American Chopper. Jason is a fabulous designer. We've gone to his shop a couple of times over the last few years, and he's always a great guy to talk with, and he's a wealth of knowledge as well. Tom Festen, my colleague, will be the moderator today, and Peter Dietrich as well, my other colleague, is kind of handling the back scenes here. And Jason, go ahead and take it away.
Okay.
Colleague will be the moderator today, and Peter Dietrich as well, my other colleague, is kind of handling the back scenes here. And Jason, go ahead and take it away.
Yeah, guys, thanks, Wacom, for the opportunity to talk to a lot of people at once here. I'm in my home office right now, and I want to introduce you to my kids and my wife, and then they're going to go off to Grandma and Grandpa's house, and we're going to get to it. So this is my 2014 edition. This is Maxton. Say hi.
Hey.
This is Kipton, 2016, right here, right? And this is Cashton. So one more is this is Crystal.
Hello.
This is my wife Crystal. Hey, it's
Anna. Hello. You are a studio butt.
Thanks, bud. Okay. So you guys. I've been overrun with little people here, so. All right, guys, beat it. Exit to the left. Okay. So, my name is Jason Pohl. I'm industrial designer at Orange County Choppers. I've been working with Paul Tuttle for the last 16 years over there. Got to see a lot of really cool stuff along the way. I think I was 21 or 22 when I started working for Paul. And you know what? A lot of the time was filmed for American Chopper, which aired on a bunch of different networks, mostly Discovery Channel. And it was aired in 160 plus countries every Monday night. So there was a lot of times where we had to meet some serious deadlines, and there was a lot of pressure, you know, and there still is. To, you know, make sure what we do is the top-notch quality and on time. So there's something about knowing that there's all those people watching you every week that you really don't want to screw up. And trust me, the producers I've worked with, they want you to screw up because it makes for great TV. So so I did my share doing that too. But what I'm going to do today is just kind of show you what I got, my portfolio, and what I've been doing and what I'm currently doing. So it's kind of showcases my workflow and how I utilize the Wacom Cintiq Pro 24 inch on an everyday basis to make money, you know, as a career. So I'm going to get right to it. This slide was, stop share. This slide was my family, which you guys got to meet live. And this is going to be right here. This is my animation that I put together. It's kind of like a demo. It's only 2 minutes long. All these bikes we've actually built at OCC for various clients. So check it out. The software used was extensive. SolidWorks, 3D Studio Max, V-Ray, Render Engine. And so check it out and I'll let you see that. Demo of the animation. Again, that was frame by frame, rendered out on the box. Averaged about 20 minutes per frame. So, you know, 60 frames a minute or a second. So a lot of overnight renders, kicking it off from, you know, from the iPad back to wherever the workstation is. So it was cool. I put them all together. I rendered them out as Targa singles. And then brought them into Adobe Premiere as a imported sequence. So that this is kind of this is like a video that I put together of just my experiences at Choppers the last 16 years. So there's a lot of really funny stuff. This kind of just shows the personalities that I work with and myself. You'll see Paul Tuttle, our owner. And Joni K, our CEO, and you'll definitely see our master fabricator, Josh Allison. So this is through the years. It's some stuff is recent, but a lot of it's, you know, it's history. So I wanted to share this with you guys and check it out. It's a big part of who I am. So. You feel that?
Tonight. adrenaline high. My need for speed's got me gunning. One touch, she screams, keep it coming. I'm getting on the bus, damn, out of your life.
So that's my family at OCC. I've been grateful to be able to work with some amazing craftsmen, engineers, and managers and everything at OCC through the years. A lot of creative people, and I've been able to forge a lot of awesome friendships that I still have to this day. So it's been a wild ride working there, and it's awesome. And I'm still there, obviously. And a lot more to come, definitely. So this sketch here is like a brawler style motorcycle that we wanted to do. It's one of my favorite. People always ask me, what's your favorite bike? What's your favorite project? And this one, for whatever reason, it really resonated with me. It's something I really wanted to do and be part of. And it was an awesome team build. And we built this for a biker build off. Where we went up against Jesse James and PJD and the Gas Monkey guys from Gas Monkey Garage. And anyways, we wanted to do like something that was unique that people haven't seen. So we took a V-twin motor and we built a frame around the motor. So the motor was actually a structure point of the entire frame. Typically you have the frame, in steel going all the way around it. But this particular case, we machined it, so it was all put together. And this was the initial concept sketch right here. And then this was that sketch taken to the next level. Just went into, I think, Adobe Photoshop and drew on top of that bike sketch and redefined some lines, came up with some shading and some textures and some overall contours, because we wanted this to have like a very mechanical, sleek feel. And something that had like a bulldog stance, something that we could be proud of. And this is the next rendering. This is a screenshot actually of all the components. Pretty much most of the components come together inside of SolidWorks. So the gas tank was unique because we machined that out of like 8 inches of billet in the back, and the frame had crossovers so the fuel could go from one fuel cell to the other on the other side, traveling through the frame. So that was pretty cool. And the oil tank was actually down here and wrapped around by the nose cone of the Evo. This is actually work in progress. It's a lot easier to cut pine than aluminum or titanium countless times. So what we did on this project is we cut the front end, we cut the frame, And obviously Quinn machined the gas tank. So we had this to mock up and work off of to get the seat height just right and the configuration of the bike, because it's our most important thing to make sure that the bikes are rideable. Every single machine we've done performs, okay? It's something you can take down the road and, you know, fist in the wind and rock and roll. So we took the time here, and you can start to see the front motor mount come together. And then here's a finished shot of the bike. Okay, we decided to chrome the gas tank. We were thinking about doing like a cherry anodize on it. That's why you see a lot of the concept renderings has like a bright red finish to it. It's the same type of shocks on the rear that are used in Formula One race cars. They're basically carbon fiber rings. So a lot of features in this. And of course we machined the front end, and the rear fender was even shaped on a CNC machine. So just had a lot of character and soul into this bike. This is a group shot at the time. It's an HDR image that our photographer took. And it's got the growl lights on and everything. So it's a pretty mean looking bike. Definitely one of my favorites. So now I'm going to show you guys inside 3D Studio Max. Okay. Because what my son's favorite bike is the one that involved this dragon head, okay? So this was for a client in Beijing, and he basically wanted something really kick-ass to go get his groceries with, and he wanted a dragon-themed motorcycle. And, you know, we were like, what, you sure? You sure? You sure you want that? And he was adamant about it. So I had fun with it because I got to utilize my video game background. That's where I started out at Incredible Technologies as a 3D modeler, environment artist, and animator. So I had a major trip on modeling, you know, every crevice of this dragon's face. And I attempted to make him look very angry. And I can show you how I did that. I used a spline cage, essentially, inside 3D Studio Max, which I've been a huge fan of for a really long time. It's very powerful software. So basically, each one of these splines or vertices has Pierre Bezier handles on them. So everything can be manipulated and adjusted until you get the curves exactly what you need them to be. Okay, so just real quick, like, and of course it's set up symmetrical, so whatever I do on one side, I'm doing to the other, right? So it's like, woo, get all crazy like that. So that was a very unique project. This actual part was 3D printed on a Fortis 400 MC by Stratus, and it was an amazing print. It was PCABS plastic. It took about 80 some hours to print out, and somewhere out there I got a time lapse of it like getting printed. It was pretty cool. So this is some more screenshots. You can see the render down here, grayscale, of the bike. The entire body was, obviously I 3D modeled the entire body and the head and the claws and the legs and the toenails, but the entire body was machined out a high density foam on a Haas VF5. And then we took those foam pieces and created a giant Ziploc bag and vacuum sealed carbon fiber to it. So it adhered and permanently adhered to the high density foam. So that's how we got that structure. And the biggest question about this I get is, where's the gas tank? Well, the fuselage is actually in front of the rear tire. So it's hidden down low. You don't really see it. And yes, I did ride this bike, and it was scary. because usually when you ride, you know, the handlebars go and everything, and you see the tire and everything, and the forks kind of roll with you. This one, that whole dragon head is inert. It does not move. So it's based on center hub steering. Okay, so the front wheel is a center hub. ISR braking from Sweden did that technology. and we machined a custom set of wheels for it. So it's kind of similar to how jet skis perform. And here's a finished shot of it. Yeah, so a lot of work. I mean, we built the entire frame from scratch. The front swing arm suspension was very unique, like I said, with the center hub. The handlebar started out as 6-inch billet aluminum and was machined down. So I'm gonna go back to 3D Studio Max here. And this is one of my favorite bikes. This was done for some really great people. Hydromat out of St. Louis, Bruno Schmitter and Matthias and Kevin. Those guys are awesome. Great team over there. And they make very, very nice CNC equipment and technology that completely blows my mind that a lot of major businesses rely on to machine parts very fast. And we wanted to do something really cool with this. I worked closely with Josh Allison and Paul Tuttle on this one. And it was just something that we really beat up everything down to the primary down here. It's chain driven, you know, and we ran a shovel head because it was the actual motor in 1979 when Bruno started his company that Harley was running. So just really cool bike. It was my first attempt. I had to machine a lot of parts for this, and it was a really good time. For just really enjoyed working on that project. I'll show you. That was the in 3D Studio Max. You know, you're modeling, you're working through it, and then this is what I kick off to my Render Pro, my Box Render Pro. And this is done in, it's a V-Ray, render. I did all the textures, all the car paint textures, all the chrome. I've messed with the adjustments a billion times. And I do all the lighting, I do all the camera angles and in the shadows, the floor, everything is all set up inside 3ds Max and then rendered out. So this is basically what it looks like when I render it out. One of my favorite bikes, it's up there. It's got a different look to it, you know. And this is just the other angle of the bike. Okay, so now we're gonna jump into another tool that I use, and this is SolidWorks. Let's go on down to SolidWorks town. Here we go. Okay, so on that bike, I wanted to make a unique air cleaner. And it's usually one of the parts of the bike that we, you know, traditionally machine. And for this one, I wanted to do something incredibly 3D, but keep it organic and have some fins to it. But at the same time, my engineering principles have to be dialed in because this bolts onto an S&S Super G carburetor. So there's really no room for air or sloppiness. So I spent a lot of time in the machine shop operating and programming the CNC machines to be able to pull off these parts. But you can see to the left, this is my stack. And, you know, nothing comes easy. You know, each one of these, you know, there's sketches upon sketches in there. And that's what I got there. Okay. So yeah, so this kind of just shows a little bit of the workflow. You know, obviously first you sketch, you develop something, and this is the water jet. So that's a 4-inch thick piece of aluminum, T6 6061. And I water jet that, okay, at our shop at OCC. And then I took that block out, bolted it onto a custom fixture that I developed in the machine, and then applied toolpath and G-code and machined it for a long time. And this is cool. This is one of my favorite pictures down here. That's Josh actually welding up the exhaust on the other end. So you get this like natural like lens flare that I thought was super special. So it's a cool picture. And there's a screenshot of what I just showed you. Here's some of the actual parts at the lift, you know, coming together. But like I said, that front end, it was very complicated for me to figure out how to fixture that and make that. It was one of my one of my first parts on the CNC, kind of. And I had actually Frank and Tom from Mari Tools helped me out a little bit. They came in and showed me what's up there. And this is what's cool about this. We wanted these badges, you know, like recessed into the gas tank. So what was really cool is, you know, Josh had these two gas tank hats that he made out of, you know, just flat stock and did all the sheet metal work. So they had all these angles to them. And then he was able to cut them out, recess them in, give me the templates with those bolt holes. And I was able to model something up in 3D space that looked pretty cool and machine it. These are the guys at Hydromat. That's Josh there from Choppers and Pohl and me, obviously. And then Bruno, Matthias, and Kevin. Good guys. This bike, this is one of those times where we really got to cut loose and do something really exotic. And it's a SNS 124 with the Thompson supercharger kicking out the front of it. And this bike is just ready to rip. It was from Miss Geico Racing. Just a very cool bike, lots of custom parts on it. And I've always been really proud of this bike. And there's the finished shot of it. So back, this is the render, obviously, 3ds Max V-Ray. And then this is the finished bike. To me, the finished bike always looks better. There's nothing better in real life. But you know what, sometimes the concepts help you weed out the bad ideas and get to the good ones. So this thing's just ready to rip. Here's some knives that I've done. This just kind of shows a workflow from a 2D sketch to a 3D model to printing it out on the object printer and then actually machining and creating it in real life. I just do that as a hobby. Have a good time with it. Here's one of my most recent knives that I've been working on. I just like the lines a lot of knives and like how they're like, it's like the oldest tool to mankind. And yet you can still make a knife that no one's ever seen before and develop your own style and put into it. So I do have a lot of passion with knives. So
Jason.
Yeah.
I see that the sketches that you come up with, how do you turn those into an actual product? What's the process of that?
Oh, I can show you. Okay. So one second. This is a render, obviously, of the knife. But if you take a quick look at this, that's basically what I start with. Okay. So that's like you know, like when you see people sketch on a piece of paper and you just get the idea across, you're just trying to weed out the bad ideas and get something to act as a takeoff point. So basically what I did with that knife is just that. And I'll show you inside SolidWorks is where that is. One second. Here we go. So this is the knife that I've been working on for a couple of years now. it's a passion of mine. It's a hobby, I guess you could call it. But when I started this off, I started with bringing that sketch actually over and into SolidWorks. And let's see if I can find it. Oh, there it is. Okay, cool. So, right, and it was OD green at that time. So let me just kind of, so what I would have done is I would have brought this in and I would have grabbed my pen tool and started drawing the splines out to extrude all the profiles up, okay? So, yeah, and it's very complicated. It's kind of like designing a watch, really, because you have all these mechanisms. Like this is titanium, and it locks the blade, it pops out, and you have all these points of contact that have to be perfect. And I'm still working it out, but it's fun. It's a fun hobby for sure. So that's that knife. Go back in. Let's see where we're at. Okay, there's an exploded view of it. I think it's 22 parts that go into that knife to make it a functioning mechanism, so it opens and closes. It's not spring-loaded or anything, but it does have a flipper tab on it. It does run on ceramic bearings and all the hardware. My buddy machined the screws out of titanium. So, you know, it does have a long way to go before it's done, but there's a couple more screenshots of it. And there it is. This is just an all aluminum. Just ignore the witness hole here and here, because that's just for fixturing purposes. That gets wiped off at the end, gets milled through. But what I wanted to show you next was another awesome piece of hardware, software that I use to rock and roll, and that's Fusion 360. It's made by Autodesk, and what it's allowed me to do is become an artist. As an artist, you know, I was always like about making stuff look really cool and function really cool and make it badass. And what it's allowed me to do is go in the machine shop that's right next to my office at OCC and just start machining out parts that before I would have had to rely on an engineer or an operator or a CNC programmer to go ahead and do. I can do it now myself with Fusion, because the way they've streamlined how easy it is to learn CAM and CAD, I can figure it out. So what this was is basically my knife handles. And if I just select these and just right click here, these are all tool paths that I've assigned to it so that I'm able to make this part. I'm gonna run simulate. And this is something that like a handful of years ago, I would have never even attempted because it was so hard and complicated. But the team at Autodesk figured out a way to, you know, get through to artists like me and, hey, you can do this. You can machine stuff. So can't say enough good things about them, especially Jamie. Jamie's a good guy. Here we go. This is just a contour. It's going around. And the green represents the stock that I water jet out on the water jet. And then I bolt it down to the gray square, which is the fixture. And this is my half inch end mill coming through. And it's just going, actually it's a 3/8 end mill going around. And I'm gonna speed it up so you can kind of see it. I'm just gonna go turbo. It's definitely not cutting in real time, but there we go. So now it's doing the roughing step, adaptive. Then here comes the scallop. I learned this from Matt Nichols over at Autodesk. He helped me out a lot, and Tim Pohl. Great guys. So I can turn off the tool path. So if it gets annoying, you don't have to see that. But basically what you get here, the time that you put in here and actually what you do here is what you get on a CNC machine is what I'm trying to say. So 90% of the time, because it's like Lil Wayne, the numbers don't lie, right? So the code that you get here when you're checking it out and what you're seeing, that's what you're going to get when you hit the CNC machine. So I just wanted to show you guys, this is a valuable part of what I do at Choppers. And I think it's important that you see Fusion run in the power of it. It's just outstanding piece of software for sure. Okay, so what is this? Okay, so this is kind of me in my natural environment right now. And I'm just going to show you, you're going to be able to see the machine shop, you know, where the coolant meets the chips type of thing. This is where we slang the metal, okay? So.
Holy shit, what are you doing? Holy shit.
This is,
I love you, buddy.
This is off our OCC Plus page. It's our online show. And that's Paul and Mike going fishing. And then here we go.
So today's a pretty crazy day in the shop. I'm gonna attempt to make a bunch of parts for the SHF bike. These veterans deserve the absolute best. I'm gonna start the day off with making a really cool air cleaner. Gonna model something up really slick, really 3D, lots of contours to it, and get after it.
such an honor to be working on this bike. It's for Veterans Day, man, and no one appreciates the veterans more than we do at OCC, so I'm honored to be working on this project.
Yeah, so that was, you got to see a couple pieces of equipment and technology there. That was our Haas VF2SS running that air cleaner. And also that was the Laser Marking Technologies Cobalt XL. It's a MOPA fiber-based laser that's just killer, man. It's got 38 wavelengths to select from and just an awesome piece of equipment. So it helps us continue to make really cool parts. Okay, so now I'm gonna take a quick break and I'm gonna show you the sketching features on the Wacom here. This is a Cintiq Pro 24-inch, and I'm just gonna show you guys like how I sketch stuff. What's really cool about this is sometimes when you're at work and you're like, oh my God, I gotta stop sitting, like I gotta stand up. You can with this, you can just like stand up and you just grab these handles and bam, you're like standing and working. I'm like standing, hey, you know? So you can actually sketch some stuff just standing up or whatever you want. And what's really, really cool, probably the most insane, awesome feature about this is anyone that draws knows that your left hand always like pushes the paper around. So you're like rotating the paper. Well, with the Wacom Cintiq, you can rotate it. See, I can actually get like real silly and like invert it upside down like a MIG, you know. But like it's nice because when you sketch, you just kind of go for it. So here, I'm gonna sketch some stuff real quick. I'm not gonna do a whole lot of time here, but I'm gonna do like a 1999 chopper, like Martin Brothers, like something long and low and crazy.
How much of your daily workflow involves the Wacom tablet?
Every day, man. And you know what's really cool about it is it's not just for sketching. Like with our website and stuff and like cutting bikes out, like if you want the bike to a final pro shot of a bike, you want it cut out so you can put like a different background in, or you want it just for a magazine quality, I'll use this pen and I'll go through and I'll trace out that photo so I can professionally remove that background from that photo. So I use it a lot for apparel design. I didn't plan to show you guys apparel design, but I do a lot of sketching and stuff, and I use this a lot for it. So cutting bikes out, merchandise, like if you take a picture of the hat, you know, the new hat your company's got, and you use this to cut it out, to remove the background so it looks pro, and then you put like a little drop shadow on it in Photoshop or something, and Bob's your uncle, and you're off to the races selling hats or shirts. So, but yeah, my point is I use it all the time. It's great. It works in any software. It really does. I mean, so a lot of times I'll use this and the mouse. I'll get some sort of freak show thing going like this. I'm like, ah. But yeah. So yeah, you can see here comes like a little seat pan.
And when you get to the CAD portion of it all, do you use the tablet for that too?
I can. I don't know if I always do, because usually it's like when I get to the CAD portion, it's like, okay, you gotta like, I geek out a little bit and I gotta start thinking math and numbers. And the entire reason I went to art school was not to deal with math. And then it hunts me down and I'm doing math again, you know? But yeah, so not always do I use it, but I can. But like, I'll use it a lot when I'm doing like sketches of. Start this
And then for your final renders, what software do you use?
I use V-Ray inside Freeze Studio Max. It's amazing. The shadows, the lights, it's like V-Ray was made to do like car paint. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And they've been great to me over there. Whenever I have any problems or anything, I hook them up. They straighten me out right away. So I'm just getting silly here, and I'm just doing like a crazy front end, you know, that is a little nutty. And what's cool about this is you can do something quick like this in front of a client, which I've done hundreds of times, and they're like, oh my God, can you do this? Oh my God, can you add this? And you can see it right away. And sometimes, like I said, it's like what you don't want to do. You know what I mean? So it's a good idea to work through when you're trying to do something super creative for like a new client. You know, they want to see different options, and they want to see different options fast, right? So when you're sketching, it's okay to have these lines go all these different ways and stuff that aren't perfect, because it's really just about the contours and the shapes that you're starting to get to. You know, it's a way to refine what you're doing. So this software, I'm sorry, is Autodesk Sketchbook, and it's amazing. And I'm pretty sure Autodesk is coughing it up for free right now. And it works on any tablet. I also have a Wacom companion, I think it is. That's basically my laptop. So I can sketch anywhere, keep the battery charged, and I'm outside, I'm anywhere, and I'm able to sketch and work from it. So Sketchbook Pro, what I like about it better than Photoshop for drawing purposes is the canvas feels more like a real canvas. It's fluid, it's smooth. You know what color? Let's pick a blue. Let's go blue. It just has better, you know, the technology that Wacom's put into these tablets, every year it's better and better. And I've had a tablet since I started working for Pohl in 2004. And I remember thinking, like, before I took a job with Pohl, I was like, man, I bet I could get a Wacom, you know. You know, when you're 21, you think silly things like that, you know. And I was like, yeah, I'm gonna get a Wacom, you know. And that's just what I wanted, because at art school, I went to the Art Institute, and that was like, you know, at the time they weren't really like drawing straight on glass like this. It was a little bit different. It was like a separate piece that you had to look at that was detached. And so this, once you do it this way, it's like, holy cow, you know, it's like, yeah, that's the way to do it, you know. And then here's just a little highlights and stuff. And like I said, I'm not going to go all ham on this and get all crazy. I got to put a little headlight here.
How did you get your start at OCC?
You know what? That's a good question. I was at Incredible Technologies in Arlington Heights, the Chicagoland area. And as an animator, doing video games, and the first project was for a brand called Orange County Choppers, and it was for Pohl Senior. And so I was the guy that was tasked with designing bikes for the video game. Okay, crazy, right? And that's what I did. And then one thing led to another, and I just needed to. I realized at a young age that I needed to make something real every day. Video games are awesome. I have a lot of good friends that make awesome video games. Granted, with all my children and everything right now, I don't have time to participate in any of those games, but I just wanted to make something that was real and that was tangible. And, you know, with choppers, like, choppers never die. They're always awesome, and you can put them in your garage and then roll them out like 30 years from now, and they're like still really badass. You know what I mean? So it's like, it was like, for me, it was like, it was something that I wanted to make something out of metal, because metal's forever, like Von Dutch says. And I wanted to, you know, express myself more. And so I was able to do that with Pohl. Pohl gave me an awesome opportunity, and I've been rocking it, you know. So here's something that's really cool. I'm going to show you guys. I'm going to turn on this radial symmetry tool. And this is just like blows my mind still to this day. And I'm sure everyone's seen it by now, but maybe not. So I'm going to put this in and I'm just got my sketch tool. And I'm just going to, just kind of sketchy. You know what I'm saying? I got a little bit of chalk. There we go. So I just put on some straight, you know, spokes. I'm a sucker for those straight shot spokes. And if you check out our new show, which was supposed to air June 9th on Tuesday on Discovery Channel at 9 p.m., we got a new date from the fine folks at Discovery, and that is going to be shifted now. Okay, so I will get everyone the dates on social media. You can find me on Instagram. I'm on Instagram once in a while. I don't have a habit of posting all the time. Unfortunately, I stay very busy, but I should post more. I have friends that post every day. I know. I'm so sorry, guys. I just don't. So you can find me on Instagram. It's Pooley. That was my nickname in high school, and it kind of stuck. And so you can find me there. And We're almost, I'm just going to town on this. It's so much fun. I forget what I'm doing. I'm drawing. I'm just drawing. Life is good. To get paid to draw is fun, you know? That was always a goal of mine. This is just a quick sketch. It just shows you the versatility of the Wacom. All right, so now I'm gonna keep on rocking here. I'm gonna go here. Check. Oh, this is really cool. We make all the championship belts for WWE over at Choppers. So it's just something that a lot of people don't know, but it's fun. It's been exciting to be able to do that and use our craft to make really cool stuff. This real quick is our partners that, you know, I couldn't do my job without these people and these organizations. Obviously Wacom, the leader in the displays for anyone that's got anything to do with art, graphic design, video editing, 3D modeling, machining. It's really endless. It's a great piece of equipment to have. SolidWorks has made outstanding software forever, and they're just great people, really powerful tool. Mari Tool, Frank and Tom over there, they've been awesome to us. We get all of our tooling for our CNC machines from them. The folks at Adobe, from Photoshop to, you know, when I do a t-shirt design, I use Adobe Illustrator. It's awesome. Adobe Premiere is how I cut up all the online shows. So if you go on YouTube and you type in OCC Plus, you can see many shows that we created in-house. It's actually really fun. But, you know, I use Adobe Premiere Pro to edit all those shows. Flow, Water Jet Systems. Our water jet machine, which is just a true workhorse for our machine shop. It's how I start pretty much every project at some point. And Autodesk, you know, those guys are the real deal. And I love the 3D Studio Max. I love Fusion 360, both really strong pieces of software that I rely on. And then Haas, Gene Haas and his team have done an awesome job at keeping our machines up to date at Choppers. And so that's the CNC machines that we trust. And Laser Marking Technologies, Sam, Rick, you guys are awesome. The Cobalt XL is amazing. It's a fiber-based laser, pretty much engrave anything. It's not what you think engravers are, it's a lot more. It cuts so deep that I'm able to use it. And people think that we CNC machine that part because there's so much depth to it and layers into the cutting. And of course, how could I forget my all-time favorite, Box Technologies. Guys, look, when you need to have a computer or workstation and you don't have time to worry about it because you're making money and you just wanna keep on making money and doing what you do, Box Technologies, they're professional equipment. It's so badass. What I have is an Apex One with a Render Pro. and this is my setup right here. I got the external hard drive. So yeah, it's this is a separate unit than this. I'm able to render out 40 processors at once. So another thing that I can do is, I mean, it just speeds up render time. So now instead of a client just getting one image of a bike render, I can do a target sequence and export out a MOV for them so they can spin around the bike and get a virtual tour of it to get approval to move forward with the build. So it just allows me to work fast. I'm never waiting on my equipment. It's always right there. And they got the best tech support system. I had an intercooler go on me on this, basically a radiator, right? And the next day at 9:30 in the morning, I had a new one at the doorstep at Choppers, and I put it in. They walked me through it. Will Kerner over there, amazing person, just really professional at his job and knows what he's doing. So everyone at Box, you know, Phil and John, guys are amazing. I can't thank you enough for such an awesome piece of equipment. So Box for life is my motto there. Just really good stuff, man. So this is just what I like everyone to take a second and look at. There's always a lot of confusion on like what I am. And for a good part of my life, I didn't know what I was. You know, I'm like, I'm a designer, you know, but I'm actually an industrial designer. So it's, you know, we all have different titles and jobs and stuff like that. And really titles are kind of meaningless. It's what you do and how you execute your job. But after a lot of careful consideration between, you know, graphic designer or designer, you know, all of those things, I feel like. But one thing that really sums me up personally is industrial designer. So, and yes, I do have my own business, Jason Pohl LLC. I take on a lot of different jobs, but mostly it's about working with clients that have a product. So it's more product design. Taking a skin and taking their product and applying a new skin to it or a new shape to it and going from there. So work really good with any team, any size, and there's always unique opportunities there to capitalize on and apply my skills. Here's some things that you should all look out for on the OCC side of things. We have OCC Plus, like I said, on YouTube. Check it out. It's digital builds. They're about 6 minutes each, and there's 6 episodes to complete one, you know, mini series of a client's bike. We are going to be on the Discovery Channel. It is not going to be June 9th at 9 p.m., but that time slot is coming, and as soon as I get it, I will try to post it on social media. If you have a long road trip and you want to laugh really hard, download our podcast. It's called Behind the Scenes at OCC, where Paul, Joan, Josh, and myself just kind of cut loose and talk about what really goes on behind the cameras that not everyone gets to see. So we don't feel like we're stepped on by editors in LA or anything. And it's just, it's a good time. It's, like I said, if you have time, check it out. It's funny. And here's my contact information. If anyone has any questions, you can email me or you can reach out on social media, DM me on Instagram. I'll get to it eventually. And I'm also on Twitter, if that's still a thing somewhere. And that's my email address. But I'm super stoked to have this opportunity to talk about myself and what I do. I don't really get that opportunity a lot of times. So I want to thank you guys. And I want to open it up. Tom, you got any questions out there or anything like that?
Yeah, I've got a few. When you're on the road, what do you use to design with?
Pencil, piece of paper, a lot of times. But I have traveled with my Wacom quite a bit. I have a Wacom companion. I try not to be on the road.
Yeah, I don't blame you.
You know, I used to be on the road. Trust me, I've seen a lot of different continents. I've been to Australia, Malaysia, Canada, somewhere else, Alaska, a lot of unique places, Ireland. And I love doing that, but now with the family so small, I travel as much as I want to. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So my boys,
you mentioned that you went to the Art Institute. How did that prepare you for the real world and getting into the business that you're in now?
You know what? The Art Institute was probably the best thing that happened to me, because when I got there, it was in a business building. Okay. It wasn't at a college campus. I feel like if I would have went to a 4-year college campus, I probably would have just got hammered and I would have missed class quite a bit. And with the Art Institute, it was more like, okay, here's your project, here's your assignment. And it felt like business. You know, it felt like a professional business. Like, okay, I got to get this project done. I got to beat everyone else out in the class. That's my competition. I got to get that money. You know what I mean? So it was kind of like a throw you in the trenches and see if you survive type of thing. And I loved it. You know, I had a good experience at the Art Institute. We had amazing instructors. I remember Rosa, McCray, a handful of them I still talk to this day. And you know what, in that area, it was so rich with video game developers that the talent pool was pretty intense. So it was good. It was good to get in the ring and have to fight right away, you know?
So we had another question about the engines, the motors that you have in your design work, the 3D and 2D ones. Where do you get those?
That's a broad question. But most of them I modeled in just SolidWorks. And like, I recycle them a lot, you know, like, in some cases I reached out to SNS, and back in the day, you know, different times they will cough up a motor or they will cough up a head or something. Mm-hmm. So that we can put it together on our screen. But a lot of times I run just the Evo that I have and that I modeled, and sometimes I'll change just the caps and it drives Josh crazy. But, you know, in my renderings, they are just the renderings. So if we go with a pan head or a knucklehead instead of the Evo, it's like, yeah, that changes. But does the stance of the bike change? Kind of. But, you know, not really. You know what I mean?
We've got someone also asking if you're willing to share those models.
I probably not.
Okay. But
I don't know. How do you answer that? You know,
yeah.
My slogan is, if you got the money, I got the time.
That's a good one.
Actually, I stole that from Hank Williams, the original. Yeah.
So when you started your career as an industrial designer, did you already know how to draw? You've been drawing since you were young, right?
Yeah, really young. And what's ironic is, like, I was never like, I'm going to be a motorcycle designer. That's what I'm going to do. Like, when I was real young. But my mom pulled out like drawings when I was a kid. I was obsessed with dirt bikes. You know, me and my cousins, we grew up in the middle of Illinois, and we had dirt bikes, we had quads, and we just, like, no rules. It just went for it, you know? And I used to paint and draw dirt bikes all the time. So it's just kind of ironic that, you know, 100 years later and I'm designing motorcycles. You know what I mean? So it's always been a serious passion of mine. It was just always in the dirt. It wasn't always on the road. You know, I wasn't like, oh, look at that old Harley going, you know what I mean? It was like, I thought motorcycles were cool, but I was really into dirt bikes, four wheelers. So it's just funny how I carried that in. And yeah, I was always painting, fine arts. I was really big into oil painting, acrylic. I still do acrylic paintings to this day. So
you should share some of that work.
You think so?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just painted Lake Tahoe. It's one of my favorite places in the world. And about a year ago, I knocked out a painting in Lake Tahoe.
That's cool.
So yeah, maybe I'll put that on social media. I don't know. I kind of feel like I'm private, you know. But, mm-hmm. You know, I maybe I could do that. They're at my house. You're making my house, dude. I'll show them to you.
Right on. Yeah. When you're designing a bike, how much time does it take for the project from start to finish? From like the initial concept to the physical bike being in front of you.
Right. Okay. I like a couple months, you know, I think like 2 months, maybe a little more is reasonable, but you got to remember, we've been put into some positions by some very, you know, aggressive producers, mm-hmm. to, you know, get the show done, get it done. Or, hey, we got a new client. You know, this client is not in the race anymore, but this client is. So at one point, you know, when things were crazy, I remember having 5 different frames that were already pre-designed and manufactured at Rolling Thunder up in Canada and ready to go. just in case, you know, this happens. So I've seen things come literally go together in weeks. You know, I know trade winds, we did two bikes in like, I want to say 3-4 weeks tops, you know, and they were like full on like custom, you know, hardcore bikes with paint jobs and everything. Wow. But it all depends on, you know, you got the money, we got the time. You yeah. know what I mean? So
how often,
but, you know what?
How I don't often like you come across clients that are asking for the impossible. How often does that happen?
No, it doesn't happen, because there's always, you know, it's got to be reasonable. You know, it's like, yeah, we're not going to like be able to put missiles on it and stuff, you know, that actually work, you know, but we've had a couple, you know, we've had a couple of strange requests, you know, what was the one? The one was, there's so many, man, that would be like a separate webinar. You know, well,
tell us the most interesting one, the funniest one.
They wanted the bike to, like, it was a blood pressure medicine. They wanted to, like, change color or quiet. They wanted it to, like, quiet down at a certain RPM so it could show, like, the blood vessels retracting. It's not really worth talking about, you know? And the dragon one was pretty crazy, dude. I'm like, wait,
yeah,
you
that's
want
nuts.
To, like, a dragon? Like, no, like a dragon, yeah. And yeah, he wanted like an Eastern dragon with like the mustache and the whiskers.
Mm-hmm.
And I got him more into like a Western dragon that looked like kind of like the dude off Mario Brothers or something, you know?
So. And do you use any 3D scanning?
Yeah, I don't right now, but we used to have a ferro arm for digitizing and stuff. And it was pretty handy, but now what I've, just the stuff that we do, I'm able to do a paper template real quick, water jet it out, verify the holes, dimensions, bolt it on, and, you know, go from there.
So it's kind of something you don't need.
Yeah, go with that route, you know. Yeah. You don't need it until you really need it, you know.
Yeah. That's with everything.
Yeah.
How often do happy mistakes make your designs better?
Once in a while, but that's another thing about like the team environment is like, if I'm drawing something and someone walks through and they're like, hey, that'd be cool if that was blue, or hey, did you ever think about making that out of this titanium or this or that, and, you know, then your mind goes in that direction. What I really enjoy doing is creating an artboard and just doing basically pinups of what you like, what styles are about, like, you know, whether it's a sports car or this or that, and you just kind of mix everything together. And, you know, just do your own thing and then just kind of let the design take over and dictate it. But there's always, you just got to pay attention, because the person next to you can have a great idea. So you really have to be a really good designer, you have to be a really good listener.
What's your best advice for young designers?
Oh, just, okay, that's easy. It's just work. You know what I mean? It's not going to be fun all the time. You have to work, and you have to really, really, really freaking want it bad. Every day you need to learn something new. Constantly put yourself in uncomfortable positions to learn from it and conquer those. Don't look at something like CNC machining. That's too hard for me. You got to be a math geek to figure that out. Try to learn it, figure it out. There's with the technology, it's everywhere. It's on your phone, it's on your iPad, it's on your computer. Google it, look up, watch how people do things on YouTube and how they mess them up, and learn from it, you know. But just always keep pushing and put yourself in those uncomfortable positions and learn from it. And each day, bit by bit, you will get better. And just never stop. Just keep going, just keep grinding, because the world wants you to stop. You know, everyone wants you to stop, because everyone is your competition. So you have to dominate them and beat them on every step. So when you take a pass and you're like, oh, I'll just go to a movie, don't. Stay home, learn something new, and push yourself, and then, you know, you'll succeed.
Yeah, so basically use that 10,000 hours concept.
Yeah, just keep going.
Yep.
Just run through a brick wall. Oh, there's nothing in here. Run through another brick wall. Just keep going.
Great advice.
Yeah, like I don't have all the answers either, but one thing that I've been able to do the last, you know, 16 years is just keep going, you know, just keep going. There's always something that's going to be put in front of you that's an obstacle, and you have to just figure out how to navigate around it and dominate it. So just keep going.
Well, I think we're just about out of questions. I've got one I'm saving for the last. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, I'm just thrilled to be able to do this and work with you guys. It's always awesome. And hopefully people get something from it and, you know, continue to go on.
Yeah, we're thrilled to have you. So the question, do you have a funny celebrity story?
Yeah, I got a bunch.
Okay, tell us the best one.
The best one is probably Bill Murray. Bill Murray was my all-time favorite. I got like so many of them, but I remember we were working on the project and it was like Paul and all them guys were going to take him to lunch. And I was like, all right, see you later, man. And Bill was like, I'm not going unless Jay goes. And I was like, yeah, dude, you're awesome. So I got a really killer lunch that day. But you know what? I ran into him years later after we built a bike for him and everything. If you guys don't know, we did a Caddyshack bike. It was ridiculous. There was like a gopher on it and everything else. It's like a golf theme. It was whacked. But I ran into him years later at Ithaca, New York at a restaurant. And what did my mom say? She said, oh, look, it's Eddie Murray. So your friend, Eddie Murray. She crossed Bill Murray and Eddie Murphy. And like, I was like, hey, Bill. And it was cool to catch up with him. But one thing that I got to show you guys now is on my Instagram. I put it on there, what Bill said about me on our show. It's really funny. He's out of control, dude. Okay, so let me see if I can find it on my Instagram here. Here we go. Here's Bill. And he commented on it too, which is great. He's so funny. Well, what's unique about Bill and me is we both are from Illinois, right? And not a lot of people know this, but right after high school, I was a mailman, okay? I was a casual carrier for 61342, and I delivered the mail an entire summer before I went to college, okay? And that's hard work. And so was Bill, right? So we hit it off, but this is what he had to say about me.
Have we gone completely sideways here?
No. If we do, that'd be good, though.
And I don't think there's a sincerity problem in there with Jason. Does it seem like it should have like a basket of some sort?
Absolutely.
It's kind of fun to like just brainstorm with guys who really can, you know, who aren't afraid to brainstorm. You know, most people kind of like try to keep the situation controlled. And I think Jason not only doesn't do that, I think Jason might need behavior modification because he seems so game. He's the kind of kid that gets picked up and taken by, you know, men offering candy from a car. I'm a little concerned about him.
Them wheels are ridiculous. Stop it, all right?
You don't like them? Well, I'm not be paying them like that.
I like them, Jason.
We're going completely.
So that was
amazing.
Yeah, that was Bill. He said I need behavioral modification. And I don't even know what that is, but, you know, my wife tells me that all the time, and I just don't listen. But and then he wrote on there. He wrote facts right there. That's Bill. So he commented on it. He just wrote facts, which is appropriate.
Yeah. Don't argue with Bill.
Yeah. So yeah, that's probably my favorite. I mean, there's been a lot of guys, really really cool people, awesome companies that have trusted us with their marketing funds to pull off something great. And it's been a riot, man. There's my boy at work with me. So, yeah. I think we did it.
I think we did it. I think that's it. I would like to thank everyone for joining us. Thanks, Jason, for being here. That was awesome. This video is going to be posted on YouTube probably tomorrow, most likely tonight. So you guys can check it there. We'll share links with all the attendees. And thank you for joining us.
Great. Right on. Guys, be safe out there. Thanks.